In this round, points are awarded to the drivers only, and so Lancia, the team leaders, have stayed away. Toyota are there, though, desperate to get their new Celica right, which has been plagued with problems throughout the season.
Sainz has a good chance of victory here and 20 points against very slight opposition. But that's what Subaru thought when they entered Harry Vatanen and Colin McRae. But in any case, the legacies were in big trouble. McRae was out after just five stages with what the team called a water location problem. It was in the oil instead of in the radiator. Carlos Sainz's rally was far from perfect at the beginning as the team experimented with the car, still searching for the right setup. He was challenged almost at once by Harry Vatanen, who actually took the lead of the rally on day two. Local hero Possum Bourne, with another Subaru, brought up to the latest specification by the Pro Drive team, was third. Italian privateer Piero Liatti was Lancia's best hope. He was quick enough. Ross Dunkerton, with an old five-speed Gallant, was never really a threat. Rod Millen in the Mazda was in lots of trouble right from the start, well down the order with electric brakes and finally the engine itself letting him down. And New Zealander Joe McAndrew, another Subaru, had a close call but moved up into the top five as all around had worse problems of their own. But he retired two stages before the end of the rally. The lead changed hands now, going from Vatanen back to Carlos Sainz for fairly obvious reasons. Things were looking better in the Toyota camp in any case as the team learned some valuable lessons about their new car and began to find the right combinations that made it work. It was academic in any case. Possum Bourne had joined McRae on the retired list and now Vatanen's oil pressure dropped off the clock and the legacy was struggling for survival. Piero Liatti took advantage of Vatanen's difficulties to jump up to second place. And then Vatanen ground to a halt in the darkness, third of the legacies to suffer terminal engine overheating. Carlos Sainz was almost left to his own devices, were it not for the determination of Lancia driver Piero Liatti. This wasn't a worked entry and Liatti didn't have the backup that Toyota gave to Sainz. But all through the second day, Liatti had been pushing and he seemed determined to continue on day three. But as Sainz streaked away in the early morning frost, Liatti made the wrong tyre choice and he went off the road, breaking the suspension and losing himself 2 minutes. The race was run now and Sainz could afford to cruise home for his third New Zealand win. It had been an important outing for Carlos Sainz and Toyota. What amounted to a very public test session had improved the car, boosted team morale and hoisted Carlos Sainz back into a 15-point lead in the Drivers' Championship, a lead he lost in Greece when none of the works Toyotas had finished the Acropolis.
Rally of New Zealand, 1992.
Thank you. Carlos Sainz on the victory dais for the third year running, the winner of the Rothmans International Motor Rally of New Zealand. Good evening, I'm Graham Booth, and I'm in the media room of the Rothmans Rally here in Auckland. Well, Carlos came here a few days ago with one specific objective. He needed those points for the World Drivers' Championship, and by gosh, he's gone away having exactly achieved this objective. He's won the rally by 4.5 minutes, and that's no mean feat. When you see him drive, you realise just how good you have to be at the very top of international motor rallying. We've been following Carlos and the 76 other drivers all the way over the last few days. Let's go back to the start of the first day.
The dashing Spaniard Carlos Sainz out for a Rothmans Rally hat-trick was always the man to beat. On the comeback trail, Finnish veteran Ari Bartonen led a concerted factory Subaru team challenge. Disaster struck early this year for New Zealand expat Rod Millen. Out for maximum points in the Asia Pacific Rally Championship, he lost over 2 minutes on the leaders in the very first stage, and he was passed by his Mazda teammate Neil Allport. Having lost the first stage, Sainz regained his seated position at the head of the field on the second. Car 3, Italian ace Piero Liatti, fell badly behind early in the rally. The punters put it down to his lack of world championship experience. The award for first trip off the road went to the hapless Argentinian Carlos Menem Jr. An excursion into the trees on the finish line put him out of the rally. Adios, Carlos. Sainz had a generous 10-second lead going into stage 3 and extended it by another 3 seconds over 9 kilometres. Ari Vartanen's entered the New Zealand International Rally 3 times, but he's never won the event. This time he was out to prove he could. Piloting the second ProDrive Subaru, Scottish boy wonder Colin McRae astounded the spectators earlier this year with a second in the Swedish rally. Astounding the spectators here, driving the third official Subaru, local hero Possum Bourne beat both his teammates and moved to second place overall. Colin McRae's times disappointed on special stage 3. At Subaru's service, we found out why.
The prop shaft broke about 2 kilometres from the end of that stage. It's four-wheel drive, so it still drives, but it's very slow. So hopefully we can sort it here okay.
Asia Pacific Rally champion Ross Dunkerton came here to continue his long-time rivalry for that title with Rod Millen. They almost equaled stage times on the Wainui Loop, but Dunkerton still had a 2-minute buffer from Millen's earlier breakdown. At 1 second a stage and 38 stages in the rally, Millen had a tall order to pull Dunkerton back. The local boys had a great day. Neil Allport, vying for first resident New Zealander honours, moved into 5th overall. Back in the forest for the final daylight stage, Colin McRae had a badly overheating Subaru. The 23-year-old was here in 1989 when he placed 5th and had high hopes of a better time this year, but it was not to be.
There's a water leak, which we're trying to cure now, but only sort of 50% hopeful of being able to cure it. Colin's not really had a chance to have a good run at a stage because this problem started on stage 3. So he was going to play himself in gently. He didn't get a chance to find out, you know, how he would be on the pace.
The first day's last stage was a publicity special at Auckland's Expo Centre. The cars ran in reverse order, making it more of a crowd pleaser. Possum Bourne was the hero of the hour, and a floodlit manufactured jump at the finish gave the crowd plenty of action.
Possum, I think the word we're all saying today is, didn't he do well?
Not so good in this stage, though. Just touched the pole, didn't he?
Crisp weather and a top-class field made day one of the Rothmans a perfect start.
Well, you've got to say that day one was really just the preliminary skirmish. The real battle was to follow on day two. The rally was heading to Rotorua, and weren't our hopes riding so high on our local guy, Possum Bourne, so far up in the field? But day two was to see us lose a lot of the top contenders, amongst them Possum. In fact, perhaps I'd better stop telling drivers that they're doing well.
For the start of day two, Sainz had a good lead on Vartanen, but the big surprise was New Zealand's Possum Bourne breathing down the Finn's neck. Neil Allport comfortably led the resident Kiwi Stakes. Fog blanketed the early stages of day two. From Joe McAndrew's point of view, it didn't hamper the proceedings as much as it did for the spectators.
Monday, catch New Zealand's great new quiz show, Jeopardy, with host Mark Leishman.
Good luck to our contestants.
Difficulties finding the best setup for the new suspension. Breaking the stage record and gaining a remarkable 11 seconds on Saints for stage 7 moved Possum Bourne into second place overall. His dream run on these familiar roads continued in stage 8. By the end of stage 8, Carlos's lead had been whittled down by a massive 13 seconds.
Carlos, day 2, how's it going?
Going okay, but the first two stages, I think we took the wrong tire choice, and I think it was not so good for us.
Saints had to watch it now, with Possum Bourne putting on the heat and reveling in it.
Yeah, one off Ari and three off Saints.
Oh no!
In Tahuna, a tragedy. It happened on stage 9. Possum Bourne Subaru stopped, and the dream run shattered. Liatti passed the stop Possum and went on to win the stage by 4 seconds.
The engine felt a bit rough, and then I saw the oil pressure start to drop a little, so it was time to turn it off. That's it for us. It's a shame, but at least we had enough time to show that we're competitive with everyone else, and that was the main thing. So maybe we get another chance somewhere.
With Bourne and McRae out, the big Pro Drive Subaru assault now fell entirely to the flying Finn Vatanen. He and Saints had a big break on Liatti and the rest, but Saints still seemed troubled by tyre choice. He lost another 7 seconds to Vatanen. Surprisingly, the Maramarua roads were unkind to Allport. He lost time to Dunkerton and Millen, but retained his lead in the first New Zealander home stakes. With stage 11's length and twisting road, tyre choice was critical, and even with 1,500 tyres to choose from, Saints got it wrong once again. His tyres were too soft for the hard base, and he punctured on this stage, losing a massive 34 seconds and his lead to Ari Vatanen. Ari narrowly missed a local hazard and shepherded the Subaru to second fastest on the stage. Stage 12 was another long and twisting one, but the speeds didn't slacken. The metric ton on this stuff is strictly for the professionals. Vatanen took 4 seconds off Saints through here, but that was only good enough for second place. Liatti had found form by now. He took this stage and moved back to within a minute of Saints. Rod Millen was also on form and started to recover his deficit to Dunkerton. Saints was still struggling on 13. He just couldn't seem to find grip on the loose surface. If Saints thought he had problems, then Vatanen had more. A puncture 7 kilometres from the end cost him 47 seconds to Saints, and with it his hard-earned lead. Piero Liatti continued his charge. Again, he won the stage. At service after 14, Ari was philosophical about the loss of time on the stage and surprised at Liatti's pace.
At the moment, we are again, I think, 18 seconds behind him. So there's a long way to go, but at least this keeps it interesting. There's a three-way battle between Carlos, myself, and this Mr. Liatti. So at least it's not dull.
As dusk fell and the cars headed for Rotorua, the Walker Bush stage saw the end of Ari Vatanen, and with it an end to the Work Subaru Challenge. The traditional Rotorua City Street Stage had no effect on the placings at the end of day two. At the end of an eventful day too, Sainz had regained a handsome lead, but now it was up to Liatti and the Aussie to take up the challenge.
Day three dawned, cool, crisp and clear. -2 degrees in Rotorua, as low as -5 degrees out in the forests. Boy, was it cold. And for the drivers and their teams, it meant they had to be very, very careful about their choice of tyres. And of course, when they were driving, they had to be real careful, because just one slip on a patch of ice, and that was the end of somebody's rally. Ahead of them, though, lay one of the biggest challenges of the lot, the Motu Gorge, some of the most challenging rally roads in New Zealand.
Carlos Sainz led out the field on an icy Saturday morning for the long run to Gisborne and back. Sainz didn't like the ice, but nevertheless he began to extend his lead over Liatti, who struggled with the icy roads. Dunkerton was under real threat from Millen by now, and their battle was turning into one of the rally highlights. The disarmingly casual Aussie was taking it all very seriously. Millen had brake problems here, but there was plenty of service time before the first of the Motu stages to get them fixed. The misfortunes for the factory team left Wellington's Joe McAndrew to fly the Subaru flag. Allport had fallen off the road earlier in the day, so he was also leading the resident Kiwi competition and lying fifth overall. After his previous tyre problems, Carlos had made the right choices on Saturday, and he set a scorching pace through the most challenging stages of the rally in the long Motu Gorge. Although he'd never been to the Motu before, Liatti was surprisingly on the pace. He dropped only 11 seconds to Carlos in 23 kilometres of unfamiliar road. There was still ice on the road. Dunkerton had a spin on the second Motu, but fortunately for him, so did Millen. Millen's was worse. It cost him 31 seconds to the Aussie.
A power-saving hint from Television One.
Had a comfortable regroup in Gisborne for those who made it through the Motu.
The Motu was okay. It was a little bit icy in some parts, but it was, unlike every year, difficult.
No problems?
Yes, big problem.
As bad as it was last year. We had a spin on the second one, and I think Rod Millen did the same, so we're both equal.
With his brake on the field established, Sainz backed off. He won stage 26 by only 6 seconds. With an earlier drive shaft problem fixed and the Motu behind him, Liatti comfortably held second. In the Mitsubishi, Dunkerton's third wasn't as comfortable. He dropped 18 seconds to Millen. In fifth place, Joe McAndrew had a 6 minute deficit to Millen, but he had a 6 minute buffer to Sundstrom at sixth. The Finnish champion, Sundstrom, easily led Group N from the start. Behind him, the Australian champion, Ed Ordinski, but he was over 2 minutes back. Group N third place was held by Yoshio Fujimoto, and Will and Heather Orr held down an excellent fourth.
Now, this year, the Motu took only one car. Gone are the days when we lost half the field when they went through there. Perhaps the drivers are now starting to realise that that piece of road really bites. So by this morning, Carlos Sainz really had the rally in the bag, and all he had to do was to drive calmly and carefully to pick up his winnings.
The run home in the Rothmans rally is the most nerve-wracking leg of the whole event. Most of the drivers have little chance of significant improvement, but the wear and tear on the vehicles and the fatigue of the crews can spell disaster. The aim now is simply to finish, and that's challenge enough. There are only six stages on the last day, none of them over 20 kilometres in length, and all of them on fast-flowing roads. There's ample service time to fix any minor problems, but year after year, the last day of the Rothmans rally takes a significant toll. Last year, it was Ross Dunkerton, comfortably in fifth place with no challenges behind and no chance of improving his position. He fell victim to tiredness and rolled out of the event. With so many positions in this year's event seemingly unchallengeable, would the run home play its usual tricks? Stage didn't change anything for Carlos Sainz. He won it easily. Liatti too drove conservatively to maintain his second position. Ross Dunkerton's third would be his best ever result on the Rothmans rally. Michael Sundstrom continued his Group N dominance. Stage 34, the Mystery Creek publicity stage. For Carlos Sainz and Toyota Team Europe, there were only three stages left to victory. After five rounds of the World Rally Championship for drivers, Carlos Sainz is in third place. By winning the Rothmans rally, he will move to first. The run home strikes. Rod Millen's bad luck with mechanical failures continues. He's out of the rally. Two to go. Toyota Team Europe have had a troubled run with their new car so far this year and have recorded only one win. The Rothmans rally would be their second. Dunkerton rolled on the stage following this last year. Once again, the run home jinx strikes. Joe McAndrew's excellent drive for first Kiwi was about to end. Before the event, Michael Sundstrom enthused about the New Zealand roads. His drive in the rally showed that his enthusiasm was well placed.